Hello and happy Saturday to everyone. Hope everyone is doing very well. Want to say thank you very much to our sponsors. And I will be introducing Venkat, who will be presenting on Active Directory and the tasks that can happen for Active Directory. I will let him take it away.
So hope everyone is doing great. Today I will be talking about understanding and attacking delegations in Active Directory environment. So let's jump into the session. So why is this session important, or why understanding delegation is an important aspect when you go for a penetration testing, is that the Kerberos delegation is a common aspect that you would find in an adversary stimulation or a red team engagement. So, and moreover, the abuse case of this functionality takes the leverage of the inherent process or the protocol flow rather than exploiting a vulnerability that is present in a software version or a piece of software component. So this would also provide you more ways into lateral movement, so that you would be able to escalate your privileges to a domain admin or higher privileges in the domain. So this is just an overview slide. My name is Venkat Raman Kumar, goes by the handle Red Wolf, and currently working as a security analyst at Vault InfoSec. I hold a couple of red teaming certifications like CRTE, CRTP. I'm also the lead of OWASP chapter Chennai. I love solving red team labs and environment. I currently research on Active Directory attacks and adversary stimulation. I also love to collaborate on learning and solving the labs. If you are interested, just ping me over my Twitter. I will be happy to collaborate with you. Do also check out my blogs at redwolfsec.in and Venkatraman10 at kitbooks.io. Hope you find it useful. So the agenda for today's session would be, we would be seeing the basics of Kerberos authentication along with the protocol flow. Why and what is Kerberos delegation? We would be also seeing through the types of delegation along with each abuse cases. So this is just a quick disclaimer here. All the demos and explanation that I would be explaining you during this session would just give you a basic insight into the attacks. If you want to understand more, research, do research. I have added a couple of references at the end of each section. Hope you find it useful. And I highly recommend you to watch these demos that I will be showing during my session over a big screen rather than a mobile device. Since it involves a lot of partial commands, you won't be able to see it clearly when you are watching it over a mobile device. So what is Kerberos authentication? It is basically a complex authentication protocol. This acts as a centralized authentication system in an Active Directory environment where the users authenticate to the servers present in the domain and the vice versa. The key components that you need to understand before jumping into the flow are KDC, which is Key Distribution Center, Ticket Granting Ticket, also known as TGT, and Service Ticket, Client and Service. Here, client and service is an entity in which the client is trying to access a service present in the domain. So let's now see what are the other three parts here. KDC, also known as Key Distribution Center, this is present in the domain controller, and it basically acts as a verification system. Once the verification is completed, it issues the service ticket as well as the DGT too. It in turn has two parts. One is authentication server, which performs the initial or the pre-authentication phase and issues the TGT. There is another part, which is the ticket granting service, which issues the service ticket upon verification of the TGT, which is present in the request. When you are talking about the ticket granting ticket, Once the pre-authentication phase is completed, the client would end up having a ticket known as TGT, and it is encrypted using the KRB TGT account's password. Of course, this TGT ticket is cached in the client's machine, so that when a client tries to access a resource, tries to access a service in a later on, this TGT gets reused again. This provides an ease of entity where the KDC does not have to replay the entire pre-authentication phase. So let's now talk about the service ticket. The service ticket is returned to the client upon the verification of the TGT ticket. The KDC provides the ticket and it is encrypted using the service account's NTLM hash. So let's now see the flow here. So this entire part is known as pre-authentication or the initial logon phase, where the client is trying to access a resource or the SQL service present in the SQL server, and the KDC is present in the domain controller. Initially, the client makes a service ticket request, which is known as ASREC, and upon verification, the KDC returns a TGT ticket along with the session key, which is known as ASREP. Again, using the retrieved TGT ticket, the client makes another service ticket request, which is known as TGSREC. And once this request is verified, the KDC returns the service ticket and a new session key to the client. This service ticket is used by the client to authenticate itself to the SQL service. And here, the TGT ticket is encrypted using the KRB TGT account's NTLM hash, whereas the service ticket is encrypted using the NTLM hash of the service account. And the session keys are encrypted using the client's NTLM hash. So this is just a basic scenario. So as I said earlier, these are the references link. Hope you check it out. You would also get to know about attacks related to Kerberos protocol, which are ASREP roasting or Kerberos roasting. So do check it out after my session. Why the Kerberos delegation was introduced by Microsoft. So this is just a classic example, which is known as Kerberos double op problem. Here, the John is a user present in the domain who is accessing a web server which is also present in the same domain. At some point in time, the web server needs to access a file present in the file server which is related to the user John. So what this web server does is that it requests the file on behalf of John to the file server. What you get is an access denied. This is because you get an access denied error because the web server does not have any sort of credential material for impersonating the user John. So how can we send the so-called credential material to the web server so that it can impersonate the user John here, for which the Kerberos delegation was introduced. So, scenario where the Kerberos delegation is used. Here, this is the same scenario, but with the delegation configuration, of course. I am not going deep into what type of delegation is configured over here. This is just a generic example, as far as now. Again, the user John is trying to access the web server. Now, the web server has some type of delegation configured over them. Now, the web server has some sort of credential material which can lead the web server to impersonate the user John and access the files present in the file server. So, the web server now makes a request on behalf of John, and this access or the request is successful and the required content is returned to the web server by the file server. So Let's now see the types of delegation here. There are basically three types of delegation, which is unconstrained delegation, constrained delegation, and resource-based constrained delegation. We would also see a common abuse case scenario of unconstrained delegation, which is also known as printer bug. That is, in turn, I have included as a part of unconstrained delegation here. So let's now start. So unconstrained delegation. When a server is configured with unconstrained delegation, it can impersonate the users who are accessing it to authenticate to any services present in the domain. So basically, when a user accesses a server that has unconstrained delegation configured, the user sends their TGT to the server. So if you recollect, while I explained the Kerberos flow, you could see that the service ticket is requested only with the TGT ticket. When you are talking about unconstrained delegation, the TGT ticket is sent to the server along with the service ticket. So the server or the service that receives the TGT ticket would be able to impersonate the user. So the server can then impersonate the user by using their TGT and authenticate to any services present in the domain. So the obvious case would be, imagine a situation where you have access to a server that has unconstrained delegation configured, and if a user who is part of a domain admin or an enterprise admin tries to access the server, you would be able to capture their TGT and gain the privileges of the particular user. And this unconstrained delegation can be configured over a mission account or a domain account. It does not basically doesn't mean any difference. So this is just a pictorial representation of what I have explained to you earlier. Here, the user is trying to access a web server that has unconstrained delegation configured. The server can now impersonate the user who just accessed it to authenticate any services present in the domain. Let that be a file server, let that be a mail server, or a SQL server, whatever. So since this is configured with the unconstrained delegation, and the user sends the TGT during this process. So this is just a domain admin perspective, where the domain admin configures unconstrained delegation over a machine account, which is SQL Server. Let's now talk about the flow analysis here. The whole flow analysis I have done through capturing the Wirecrack packets, and I have made a table along with the pictorial representation so that you would be able to understand it in a better way. So initially, the four steps are normal, is a part of normal Kerberos protocol flow, and the rest is the unconstrained delegation part. Initially, the client makes a request to the KDC for accessing the web service, and once the verification is done, the KDC returns the TGT ticket. Using this TGT, the client makes a request to the KDC for getting the service ticket. Once that verification is done, the KDC returns the service ticket to the client. Since the web service has unconstrained delegation configured, the client again makes a request for a specific or special TGT to be returned by the KDC, which is forwardable TGT. Forwardable TGT is nothing but a normal ticket granting ticket with forwardable flag set. And once that the verification part is done, the KDC returns the TGT ticket with forwardable flag set. Then the client sends the service ticket and this forwardable TGT to the web service, and the web service returns the required content in the eighth step. And at some point in time, the web service needs to impersonate the client and access the contents of SQL Server. So using this TGT, the web service makes a service ticket request to the KDC. Once the verification is completed, the KDC returns the service ticket here. Once the web service has the service ticket, it makes the authenticates to the SQL Server and has the service. It has the service ticket for accessing SQL Server. The required contents are returned in the 12th step. Let's now talk about the obvious case of this. So first we would be enumerating the accounts that has unconstrained delegation configured. I would be using the tool or the script Power View. You could also use the native Active Directory module. And of course, this is an assumption where you have bypassed all the antivirus protection and the Windows Defender things so that the execution is uninterrupted. So you would be enumerating the list of accounts through this command, get domain computer -unconstrained. Once that is done, you need to access the server that has unconstrained delegation configured and monitor for the Kerberos tickets. More specifically, sensitive Kerberos tickets using Rubus or Mimikatz. I would be using Rubus during my demo. Once the TGT is captured, you could import the TGT into the last process via Rubus or Mimikatz again. So let's now see the demo here. So here, what I'm doing is that I'm starting the Rubus with the monitoring mode enabled. I'm also having an interval of 3 seconds. I'm specifying the flag no wrap so that the acquired TGT is in the form of a single string, and so that I could directly copy and paste into the injecting process without any hiccups. I do not have any sensitive TGT captured over here. Now, this is the domain controller, which is redo-dz. Here, the domain admin is trying to access the website that is hosted over sqlserver.redo.local, and this sample website requires the domain authentication. If the domain authentication is unsuccessful, you would end up receiving an error like this. So I'm just reloading it here. Yeah, you end up having the authentication screen where you need to enter your domain credentials. And Deadpool is a user who is part of the domain admin group and he is entering the credential. And since the valid credentials are entered, the sample website is being loaded here. So you could see that I have captured the valid TGT of the user Deadpool here. Let me just see whether I'm able to access the files present in the domain controller. You could see that I receive a permission denied error. Now, let me just inject this TGT ticket into the memory using the Rubus again. So you could see I'm able to access the file contents now. You can also PS remote into it if PS remote PowerShell remoting is allowed in that particular system. So this is just a demo. So let's now talk about a slight variation of unconstrained delegation, which is commonly known as printer bug. And guys, do not confuse this issue with the printer nightmare or the print nightmare issue, which has been actively exploited nowadays. Printer bug is a configuration which is present in the Windows printer print system remote protocol, which is also known as MSRPRM. So this is a protocol which is running on the spooler service present in a print server or a domain controller as well. So abuse case would basically force any machine that is running the spooler service to authenticate to an attacker controlled machine that has unconstrained delegation configured. That may be via Kerberos or NTLM. Thus, since this is trying to authenticate to a machine that has unconstrained delegation configured, the attacker would end up having the machine account's TGT here. So this is basically done via a remote procedure called API, which is RPC remote find first printer change notification. This is a big name. I cannot remember it. Once this API is called, the target system attempts to authenticate to the compromised host here, which has unconstrained delegation configured, and this system's TGT is captured. So you could use a spool sample exe for exploiting this printer bug. So let's now talk about the abuse case scenario. Initially, you need to check the target whether it has the printer spooler service running. You could do that through the ls command. Here you need to specify the target host name. If you have a share enabled, you can exploit it. If not, you get an access denied or a path error, you won't be able to exploit it. You require domain user's credential or access for any domain user present in the network. Once this is done, access the machine that has unconstrained delegation configured, and same as the exploitation scenario that we saw earlier, start the Rubus or Mimikatz for monitoring the sensitive TGT that is being captured. You could do that to Rubus monitoring mode. I'll interrupt 2 seconds. Next step would be forcing the target to authenticate to the attacker machine. So this is again done by the spool sample. So let's now see the abuse case here. So here I would be exploiting it in two ways. One is taking over the domain controller of the root domain, and another one is exploiting the child domain's domain controller. So I was able to list the share which is present in the spooler service for the Redbull TC, which is the root domain's domain controller. Let now see what is happening for the child domain. Okay, both has printers with the service running. So let's now start the Rubus. We have no sensitive TGT captured here. Now I'm trying to capture the root domain's domain controllers mission TGT, mission accounts TGT here, which is Redbull DC's mission account. You could see that I have captured the TGT of the Redbull DC, which is the domain controller. And once you have successfully captured it, again, we could import it into the last process via Mimikatz or Rubus again. I won't show that part. since we have talked about it in the earlier demo. So now I'm trying for the child domains domain controller here. You could see that we have captured the ticket. So that's it. So these are a couple of the references. I hope you check these out. I highly recommend you to read the blog that are created by the Spectre Up guys. They have an awesome thing where you get to know escalation, privilege escalation among the forest through exploiting unconstrained delegation. So let's now see the constrained delegation. The difference between unconstrained and constrained delegation is that while we are talking about constrained delegation, this has a specific set of restrictions implemented over the delegation configuration so that the server can only access specific services present in the domain via the delegated credential. So when a user accesses a server with constrained delegation enabled, the server can impersonate the user to access only specific services present in the domain. The list of specific services are specified over the machine accounts attribute called MSDS allowed to delegate to. This is the attribute name, and the list of services that can be accessed via an impersonation are specified here. There are basically two extensions that you need to consider before understanding constrained delegation. One is Kerberos protocol transition extension, which is also known as S for U to self, and constrained delegation extension, which is S for U to proxy. So this is just a scenario, this is just a domain admin perspective, which we will be seeing in the demo. Here I have configured the constrained delegation property to the service present in the domain controller, which is the SIP service, and I have configured with use any authentication protocol here, which combines S for U to self and S for U to proxy here. So let's now see what is S for U to self and S for U to proxy here. So S for U to self basically allows a service ticket, allows a service to make a service ticket request for itself, and this service ticket has a special flag called forwardable flag set over it. Cases where you would be seeing the constrained delegation is when a user authenticates to a service via a non-Kerberos protocol, let's just say that may be an NTLM or CRED SSP, you would end up having this scenario. And the only way you would be having a forwardable service ticket retrieved is the machine account, if the service account has entrusted to auth delegation set. If normally any machine account can invoke S for U to self here, but you would end up having a service ticket that does not have the forwardable flag set, whereas the machine account which has the trusted to auth for delegation set, you would be able to retrieve the service ticket with the forwardable flag. Why is this forwardable service ticket required is that this is the key for making a request to access the service which is specified in the MSDS allowed to delegate to option here. So S for U to proxy, basically what it does is that allows a service to make a request for the service ticket to any service or any SPN that are specified in this attribute of the machine account. And again, as I said earlier, the service ticket that is retrieved from this step is required for this purpose. this is just a pictorial representation. Here, the user is trying to access the web server, and once the authentication or the access is successful, at some point in time, the web service which has the constraint delegation configured and it is pointing to the SIF service of the file server, and the web server cannot impersonate the user in accessing any services present in the domain rather than the file server. So since it is explicitly specified here, the web server can only impersonate the user on accessing the SIF service of the file server. Other resources or other services cannot be accessed via impersonation. So let's now talk about the flow analysis here. So here, the client authenticates to the web server using an NTLM authentication, and some point in time, the web server needs to access the service or the SQL service impersonating the client. So the web service, using the TGT of the web service, makes a request to the KDC asking a specific service ticket with a forwardable flag set. The KDC, upon verification of this request, sends the TGT to the client, to the web service, and using this special service ticket, it makes a service ticket request for accessing the SQL server here. As this has the forwardable flag set, the client, the KDC verifies that the SQL server is listed over the attribute, delegation attribute here, which is MSDS allowed to delegate to, and the KDC returns the service ticket for accessing the SQL server. And with this service ticket, the web service impersonates the client and accesses the SQL server here. So the basic or the abuse case scenario would be to enumerate the account that has constraint delegation configured. We could use the two commands from the Power View again. This get domain user - trusted to auth and get domain computer trusted to auth. We must have either the password or the NTLM hash or access over any one of these accounts. So you could use Rubus for the exploitation part, or you can also use Kiko here. While considering Rubus, you would be invoking the S4U to self module, and you would be specifying the web service along with its NTLM hash and the domain and the user to be impersonated, which is the Deadpool, of course, he is the domain admin, and this is the service which is listed in the MSDS allowed to delegate to property of the mission account web service, and the rest of the part is alt service which you require the service ticket and you are directly injecting it in the last process. So this is the Rubus part. When we are talking about Kiko here, you would be initially capturing the TGT ticket of the web service here. So for capturing or for getting the TGT ticket, this is the command TGT -ask. You are specifying the account name, domain, along with the NTLM hash. Once that is done, you are using that TGT into invoking the S4U2 module. So let's now see the demo here. So you could see that I have access of web service account, and you could see that the user web service has MSDS allowed to delegate to option configured, and this is set, this is pointing to the SIF service present in the domain controller, which is Red Bull 5DC, and it has the trusted to auth for delegation flag set. So let's now capture the TGT of the web service account using Rubus again. So this is the TGT of the web service account that we could use for invoking S for you to self and S for you to proxy. So again, as I explained earlier, I'm loading the S for you to self and S for you to proxy module here, and I'm specifying the user web SVC. I'm also specifying the ticket where I am adding the value of the captured TGT. Then I'm specifying the domain name along with the user to be impersonated and the MSD SSPN value is set to the service that is listed over here. So you could see that I have specified that value here, and I am giving the alt service to the LDAP service, so that I need to get the service ticket for the LDAP service. So you could see that once the command is ran, the ticket has been successfully imported into the memory for the service LDAP/RedDC. So I have invoked the service ticket for LDAP so that I could demonstrate the DC sync attack here. So I have started the Mimikatz here. And I am listing the active Kerberos tickets. You could see this as the service ticket for the LDAP service. Let's now try to perform DC sync attack here. I am trying to dump the KRV TGT upon CentLMS. You could see that I was successful in it. So that's it. Again, this is the references slide. Do check it out after the session. So let's now talk about resource-based constraint delegation. Again, this, when you compare this with constraint and unconstrained delegation, this in turn enforces another set of restrictions which would end up having the abuse case scenario here. Here, the delegation property is configured over the service or the server that receives the delegated credential from a particular service. So, to be more simple, while considering the other cases, the delegation property was configured over the web service account. Here, the delegation property would be configured on the SQL server, which is receiving the delegated credential from the web service. So the delegation property, which is MSGS allowed to act on behalf of other identity, I guess it's quite big. And this attribute is set on the SQL server, and this is pointing to the web service, which sends the delegated credential to the SQL server. So the abuse case scenario would be when a user, you have access over the particular user account, has the write permissions over a machine account. That may be generic call or generic write or write DACL property. It's basically an abuse of the ACLs. This would end up configuring the RBCD or the resource-based constraint delegation, and once that is done, you would be able to abuse it through taking over that account. So this is just a pictorial representation. I hope if you could recall, in constraint delegation, the delegation property was configured over the web server account. Now the delegation property is configured over the file server, that receives the delegated credential from the web server. Since the property is set on the file server pointing to the web server, and now any user who is trying to access the web server can be impersonated, and this can access the file server impersonating this user. And any other impersonation is not allowed here. Basically the delegation is the property is configured over here rather than configuring over the the web server when you are talking about constraint delegation. So yeah, this is a comparison graph or the image. Here, in both of these cases, the delegated credentials are sent from the service A to the service B, and the service B is the one who is receiving the delegated credentials here. But while you are talking about the constraint delegation, the delegation property is configured over the service A pointing to the service B. When you are talking about resource-based constraint delegation, the delegation property is configured over the service B, which is pointing to service A. So, yeah. And this is the abuse case scenario where you have the domain controller and you have the web service account which has the generic write property over the domain controller. So the abuse case scenario would be you would end up initially while you're talking about the abuse case of RBCD is that you need to have two things. One is that either you need to have access over S4U to self enabled account, and you need to have an account that has generic write property over the target system that you are going to take over. If you don't have the account which has N4U to self enabled, you can end up creating a machine account that I won't be covering during this session. So initially what I am doing is that I am storing the machine account in a variable known as target computer, and I am just enumerating the users that has trusted to opt for delegation attribute set, and I am also enumerating, also I am storing the variable attacker SID with the value of the web service account's SID. So once this is done, I am verifying the generic write permissions on the target computer through enumerating the object ACLs specific to the target computer, which is Redwood DC, and matching that to the attacker SID. And I am listing the access control list. And once that is done, the verification part is completed. Now we are turning into the exploitation part. So here, I am storing the name of web service account which has S4U to self enabled in a variable. I am converting that into a security identifier. Once the conversion is completed, I am substituting, or I am converting that into raw SDDL format, which is also known as security descriptive definition language. And this in turn gets converted into the binary bytes. So this all sort of conversion is taking place so that I would be able to set the property MSDS allowed to act on behalf of other identity over the target system. This is the command for setting that property. Once that is done, I would be able to use Rubus and capture the TGT or the service ticket here. So let's now see the demo here. You could see that I have generic write permissions on Redwood DC for the mission, for the service account web SPC. So here, just quickly wrapping it up. Okay. So here, as I said earlier, I'm storing the name of the target, which is Redbook DC on a variable. And I'm also enumerating the list of user accounts or the service accounts that has trusted to or for delegation set. Here, the account that has generic write property over the target, as well as which has the delegation property set, are same, which is web SDC, of course. So I'm storing the attacker SID in a variable. And next, I'm enumerating the list, access control list, for the domain controller and matching that with the attacker SID here. And I'm simply printing the variable that was retrieved from the result. You could see that there is generic write property set and access is allowed here. Okay. So here, I'm basically storing the web service account identity in a variable and converting that into security identifier. Once that is done, I'm converting that into the raw as DDL format. After that, binary conversion takes place. Once all this is done, all the conversion part is done, I'm setting the attribute called MSDL DS allowed to act on behalf of other identity using the SD bytes, which in turn has the value of web service, which has the S for you to self enabled, or which has the delegation property set. So you could see that I have the web service account, will now use the rubus here. I am specifying the NTLM hash here, and I'm specifying the user to be impersonator, which is the domain Deadpool, who is a domain admin. And I'm also specifying the service. This could be any service present in the target system. I'm just specifying the SIP service. So I'm requesting the service ticket for most of the services present in the machine account, which is LDAP, WinRM, SIFS, WSN, and I am injecting directly into the memory. So let's now see the active Kerberos list, Kerberos tickets. So you could see that this has all the service ticket that I had requested earlier. And again, I'm performing the DC sync attack. Great, I got the DC sync attack was successful. So that's it, guys. Again, this is the reference slide. So do sure to check it out. Thank you all for listening to the session. I need to specially thank Diana Initiative for providing me an environment to share my insights about Kerberos delegation. A little shout out to bunch of people. One is Cheryl Biswas, who mentored during my presentation preparation, and my Tamil Nadu Cybersecurity Council family, and Karthikeyan K, who is my mentor. These are my handles, guys. Do sure to check it out. If you have any doubts related to Active Directory attacks or delegation, you could reach me out anytime. I would be happy to help. So, yeah.